me ask you to open your Bibles to the book of Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and it is an honor and privilege to be here with you. Thank you so much for the invitation, and thank you for the food. We ate last night with Sister Connie and Brother Buddy, and it was wonderful. We ate tonight with Sister Vera and Brother Jerry, and Brother Jerry can cook. He married really, really good. I was sharing with Brother Darrell and Brother Ben earlier. I do not remember a time when I did not know Brother Jerry. I just can't remember. I was born in Titusville, Florida, when my father was pastoring there, and just some of my earliest memories of church involve him there in the church. And it was just wonderful to spend a little bit of time with them, and it's just a delight to have the opportunity to stand before you and share from the Word of God. So I've asked you to turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. This chapter has been called the Faith Hall of Fame of the Scripture for good reason. There, the subject of the chapter is faith, and then there are examples that are listed, drawn from the Hebrew past and paraded before us. And there's a list of familiar names with their acts of faith that are shared with us, names that are very familiar, names like Noah, Abraham, Moses are included in the list. And then along with them, there are some not so familiar names that are referred to as well. And I'm really thankful for the inclusion of the names that I'm not so familiar with. You see, maybe the guilt's on me, but I'm really not moved that much when I read about the faith of Moses. Maybe I should be, but I'm not, because he's Moses. And Moses, you know, is a household name in some households. And so I'm somewhat familiar, but then we come to some names where I have to scratch my head and say, who was that guy? And I like that, because it's a reminder that you do not have to be a well-known name for God to take notice of you. You don't have to be a headliner. You don't have to be one of those names that everybody says, oh, yeah, I know that guy. For God, for heaven to sit up and say, I know you. And so I'm thankful for the inclusions. And then there are some names that they're not just obscure, and they almost make you scratch your head and wonder, why are they on the list? I mean, what was it about this person that God looked down and said, this person was not just an honorable mention, but the faith that was exhibited in their life is worth being mentioned with all these other names in the book of Hebrews chapter 11. So I want you to look with me, Hebrews chapter 11, because if you don't get anything else, I hope you get this. Obscurity is no obstacle to God. You may think that you are kind of an obscure person, and not a whole lot of people know you. You may not be somebody that moves in circles where other people make way when you walk into the room. You may say, you know, if I disappeared off the scene, I'm not sure other folks would really notice that I've disappeared off the scene. You may consider yourself one of those people, but please understand, your obscurity is not an obstacle to God. God is willing to use those that are very prominent in society, and God is just as willing to use those that society doesn't even recognize. God is willing to use those that have names that gain the attention and the ear of others, and he is also just as willing to use those that perhaps nobody else really knows. And Hebrews chapter 11 just is testimony to that. So look with me if you will. Hebrews chapter 11. If you're there, say amen. I really like us to stand if we can. I don't read long text, but the Word of God is really worthy of our attention. Hebrews chapter 11, look at verse 30. Two verses I want you to notice. Verses 30 and verse 31. Word of God says this: by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, when she had received the spies with peace. And then the writer goes on and leaves Rahab, but here she is. And Rahab is one of the names that I least expect to find in Hebrews chapter 11. I mean, Rahab, and you notice that she's referred to as the harlot, Rahab. I understand something. thousands of years passed between the battle of Jericho and the writing of the book of Hebrews. Thousands of years have passed, and Rahab still has this title attached to her. I mean, that's long ago, and yet that's how she's remembered. That's how the Bible often refers to her when it does refer to her. And so she's just not the person that I'm looking for, but yet here she is. Here she is in a chapter where the Holy Spirit inspires the writer of Hebrews to remind us of human examples of men and women that lived lives of faith. I mean, they just trusted God for huge things and lived. It wasn't, their faith was not theory. Their faith was not something they just believed in. Their faith was something that was lived out. And so it's really important that Rahab is here, that Spirit of God is working with the writer of Hebrews, and her name is interwoven in with all these other names as great people of faith. She's not who I'm looking for, but she's there. But please understand something. God was able to see in Rahab what perhaps nobody else was willing to see in Rahab. God, listen, other people would remember her past, but God remembered her faith. Others may remember what she was guilty of, but God remembered what she had been forgiven of. Other folks may have saddled her with a title and a reputation that for thousands of years she could not live on planet Earth. Let me tell you something. That reputation does not follow her into heaven. What follows her into heaven is that she was a woman of faith who served God. And so our past may follow us around down here. There may be people that can remember what you did 20 years ago, and they want to saddle you with that. I've got good news. When God forgives, he forgets. And he doesn't just forgive and forget. He gives us a new lease on life, a chance to live a life that is honoring and pleasing to him. And if Rahab can make Hebrews chapter 11, there's none of us who cannot live a life that is pleasing to God. If Rahab made this list, then there's none of us that have something in our past that is so bad that it would hold us back from having a future that is really good in the eyes of God. There's an opportunity for each of us. Would you bow your heads? Father, thank you. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, that your word has some folks like us in it. Folks that may have more imperfections than we have good qualities. Folks that may have things in our past, Lord, that we just wish weren't there. And sometimes we let Satan remind us what we've done as if what we've done would prevent what could be done. Lord, thank you for including Rahab in the scriptures. I pray, Lord, that as we spend these moments together, that we'll open our hearts and open our minds. We'll allow your spirit, we invite your spirit to come speak to us, Lord, on a personal level, to encourage us, Lord, to serve you. Because if Rahab can serve you, Lord, I can serve you. Lord, I thank you for your word. Ask your blessings upon our time together. May you be pleased with the decisions we make before we leave here. And we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. You please be seated. I like the account that's before us. First of all, understand something. The biblical account of the Battle of Jericho is almost too fantastic to believe, to be honest with you. I mean, when you read that account, and some of you are familiar with that account, so Moses has led the children of Israel up to the entry of the promised land. The 12 spies go in. They come back with a mixed report. The folks don't, there's absence of faith, and 40 years in the wilderness follow. And during those 40 years, the children of Israel learn to believe God. They learn to have faith. I mean, there's a lot that happens in those 40 years, but there's some things that happen on a weekly and almost daily basis. Every morning they get up and they walk outside 6 days a week, and God has fed them every single day. I mean, the manna is waiting there to be picked up. For 40 years, they go through the wilderness, and every time they're thirsty and they can find no water, God provides water. They learn to just have faith in God. And so that after 40 years, the Jewish contingent that Joshua brings to the promised land is not the same Jewish people that Moses brought to the promised land. In two ways. A lot of them have died off. In fact, the whole generation has died off. And the folks that come now to the promised land following Joshua, they've spent 40 years of their life with God providing everything they need. If Moses had come to Jericho, and if Moses had told the Hebrews he led, here's the plan, we're going to march around the city once a day, and then on the last day, we're going to march around the city seven times. On the seventh time, we're going to blow the trumpets, and the walls are going to fall down, and we're going to win the city. They would have stoned Moses. But the folks that Joshua leads there to Jericho, when Joshua says, here's the plan, we're going to march around the city once a day. On the final day of the week, we're going to march around the city seven times. And then at the seventh time, we're going to shout, we're going to blow the trumpets, and God's going to knock the walls down. And they said, let's go. No hesitation. They're complete faith in God. They've learned to trust that when God says, they can trust. And so the story of Jericho itself is fantastic. But beyond that, then there's Rahab. There's this woman named Rahab that comes to the surface in the story. You may be familiar with her. The spies are sent into Jericho, and I don't know exactly why Joshua sent them there, but they go, and while they're there, someone gets word, hey, some Hebrews have come in, and we need to capture these Hebrews, and they end up on the seedy side of town. And they end up being protected by Rahab. She shelters them and provides a way for them to escape the city. And along the way, she negotiates some safety from them. I'll keep you safe, and you keep me safe, and I'll keep you safe, and I'll let you get away and escape the authorities. But when you conquer the city, I want safety. And so they make an agreement. And the agreement is you get everybody in your house, and you mark your house with a scarlet thread out the window, and whenever God gives us this city, we will protect those that are in your house. And lo and behold, that's exactly what happens. That's exactly what happens. It's a fantastic account, but then we find her here. We find her here in Hebrews chapter 11, and a far greater significance in Jericho is this woman named Rahab. We meet her briefly towards the beginning of the Old Testament, at least the beginning for us, chronologically. And then we almost forget her until we come to the New Testament, and we meet her again. Once again she's brought to the surface, not just in Hebrews, but she's brought to the surface in the ancestry of Jesus Christ. She is literally an ancestor of that earthly side of Jesus, that body that God roamed earth in. She's there, and so she's a woman that not only is mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11, but she's already been honored by God by being an ancestor of the body that Jesus Christ is. So I want you to just stop and think about her for a moment, if you will, because there are some wonderful lessons for you and I to learn from Rahab and this woman of faith. There's three things that I want you to think of. First of all, get this. She may have been the most unlikely woman to be considered a woman of faith. I doubt she would have been invited to speak to any ladies' groups. Folks would not have gathered around. Rahab's coming to town. Let's go hear what Rahab, the harlot, has to say. She may have been the least likely, the most unlikely. I don't know why the Hebrew spies ended up on that side of town. I really don't. I don't know what they were looking for when they ended up over. I have questions, I don't have answers, but there they are on that side of town where Rahab is running her business. Here's what I do know. I knew though that it was no surprise to God that they ended up on that side of town. And it was no surprise to God that they met Rahab along the way. This was not an accident. This was God's working. This was not just something that was coincidental. It just kind of happened. This was the hand of God at work in their life. And consider her occupation. She is a prostitute. That's what she is. And we don't know the circumstances that led her down that walk of life. We don't know. Here's what's safe to say. Nobody grows up and dreams that one day I will sell my body to provide for myself. And yet that's exactly what we find Rahab doing. That's right. Well, what drove her there? We don't know. Was did she have some addiction? Was she involved in slavery? Was human trafficking? Was she a victim of that herself? Was there? Well, we don't know the desperation that brought Rahab to this place at this time in her life. We don't know. We knew that life had taken her to a really, really bad place. Life had taken her to a bad time. And nobody wants to grow up and be what Rahab had become. And yet there she is. And I find it a wonderful thing that God sent some of his people to Rahab's house. Rahab was important to God. I don't know how important she would have been to us. I don't know if we would have just written her off and gone to the house next door instead of going there. But she was important to God. By our standards, she may have been the most unlikely to ever be considered a woman of faith. But God had great plans for Rahab. He planned on making her an ancestor of his own son. She may have been the least likely person in the world for that. But here she is. And I like it. In fact, I love it. Because there's hope for somebody like me. Man, if there's hope for Rahab, there's hope for all of us. If Rahab can come from such a low place to such a high place, then is there any of us that God couldn't use? I mean, I don't know where you are in life today. I don't know where life's taken you. I don't know where you've driven life along the way. I don't know. But I know sometimes we come to some spot that it's really low. And we sometimes think, God, I don't know how I got here. And we sometimes even think things like, I'm not sure God could love somebody like me. I'm not sure God could really care for someone that has done what I've done, that's been where I've been, that whose hands have been guilty of what my hands have been guilty of. And then we come to Rahab. And who knows what Rahab was guilty of? Here's what I do know. God is guilty of loving Rahab. God is guilty of caring for Rahab. He sends this ambassador. They think they've gone to spy out the land. It could be that Joshua had, who knows what his motives were for sending them there, but it could be that God's motives of the spies going into Jericho was just so they would meet Rahab. It may be that God knew that there was one person in Jericho who one person who might listen, one person who might make a good decision, and that person, they're there. And Rahab encounters them, and Rahab's eternity changes with what seems to be a chance meeting. She may be the most unlikely, but here she is, a woman of faith. It's no coincidence. Very well may have been providence that God led her there. Here's what I know. No one is so far away from God that God can't reach them. No one. Wherever you are in life, you are within reach of God. Whatever it may be in your past, it's not something too big for God to forgive. Whatever it is, it's not so bad that God cannot cover it in the blood of Jesus and walk away from it as if it never had happened. Because that's what he does. I mean, you understand, I hope, that when Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, he did not just die for the sins of some people, nor did he just die for some of the sins of all people. But Jesus died on the cross of Calvary to pay for all the sins of all humanity. And whatever it may be that we're guilty of has already been paid for by Jesus. When I ask God to forgive me, Godhead doesn't have to sit around and say, well, you know, Jesus, I don't know what you think about it. That was pretty bad. There's not a huddle in heaven about whether or not my sin can be forgiven. My sin has already been paid for. I mean, the tab's already been picked up. If I leave this life with my sin unforgiven, it's not that my sin was too big for God. It's that I wasn't humble enough to come to God. God's already paid for it. He's already taken care of it. Rahab stands as a shining example that our obscurity and our sin is no obstacle to God. That there's no place so far away. There's no person so low. There's no sin too bad. There's no lifestyle that we've been in too long to come to God. I don't know how long Rahab had been a harlot, but here's what I know. Her life changes in this moment. She's never the same. Something else. She is undeterred. She's unlikely to be a woman of faith. And she's undeterred in her faithful service. You remember the account. Whoever she kept in her house is saved. Whoever she keeps in her house, when Jericho is conquered, they are delivered. It's Jericho is one of those archaeological ruins that's wonderful to stand and look at, and it's even more wonderful for me to read what those that have dug there have uncovered. And among the things they've uncovered, that the walls of Jericho did not, they didn't fall down over because of deterioration or because of decay. They fell down in a moment in time. They're able to determine that the siege of Jericho was not a very lengthy siege, because what they found is the evidence of a city full of food whenever it was conquered. And what generally happened was that a city would be surrounded in siege, cut off from any supplies coming in or anything going out, and the army stayed on the outside until the folks on the inside ran out of food and ran out of water and finally decided to come out and fight. And the folks on the inside are hoping the folks on the outside will give up and leave, and the folks on the outside are hoping the folks on the inside will come out and fight. That's generally the way it happened, but in Jericho it doesn't happen anything like that, because when the city falls, it is full of food. They haven't run out yet. And on top of that, there's a portion of the wall that doesn't fall. Doesn't fall. You remember where Rahab lived. She lived against the wall. So the spies were able to go right out the window and be gone. That's amazingly enough. There's a portion of the wall that it doesn't fall. It stands. It's the hand of God. It seems so fantastic. You and I would say, but that's just who God is. God's able to bring a big city to ruins. He's able to take a symbol of strength and stability like Jericho was and turn it into just a place of ruins. And you're right, he is. But he's also able to take a life that is in ruins and make something wonderful from it. He can do more than just take a city and turn it into ruins. He can take a ruined life and make it a shining lighthouse. And that's what he does with Rahab. I don't know. I don't know how Rahab is able to convince anybody to come into her house. I really don't. I don't know how she's able to convince her family or friends that she has a message that they don't have, that she has something from the people of God that they haven't heard. And if they just come into her house, and if they're just there, stay there, that they're going to be safe. I don't know how she can, but she does. She does. She convinces those to come into her house. I don't know. I don't know. Well, why should her parents believe their harlot daughter? Why should her neighbors believe her and be involved in the conspiracy? Because keep in mind, Rahab has aided and abetted those who have come in to do harm to the city. She has put herself at odds with the authorities of her day, of her community. How does she convince anybody to come alongside her? But she does. She does. You know what? You might say, I would love to reach my neighbors. But you know, they know who I've been. And I don't think they'll listen to me. Somebody listened to Rahab. And she'd been carrying around her reputation for a couple thousand years. Somebody listened to her. You might say, well, I'd love to reach my family, but every time I talk to them, they remind me of something from my past, and I just don't think they'll ever listen to me. They listen to Rahab. They listen to her. You say, well, how? I don't know. I don't know. Maybe she just kept talking. Maybe she didn't quit. Maybe she saw the urgency. She doesn't have a lifetime to convince them. She's got 7 days. She doesn't have an extended period of time. She can't say, I'm going to invest in this relationship, and maybe
think it's an accident that one of those Hebrew guys decided, hey, she's got a boy. I think I'd like to marry her. It's an accident that she just happens to get married to somebody from the tribe of Judah. Is it an accident that she just happens to have a great-great-grandchild whose mom was Ruth? Is it just an accident that she becomes an ancestor of David? Is it an accident that as the New Testament writer sets out to record this genealogy of Jesus, that along the list of some names, you say, man, what a pedigree Jesus had, but along the list, there's Rahab. And while it was not common to mention the ladies that are involved in the pedigree, in Jesus' case, there's more than one lady that is mentioned. And each of them are a trophy of grace. It's not an accident. God was honored by Rahab, and God honored Rahab. She's unforgotten. So here we are, 2019, and when I speak of Rahab, I still call her by her ancient title, Rahab the harlot. And on planet Earth, her past still is unforgotten. Among humanity, there's still a memory of where she came from before she came to God. But in heaven, it's not that past that is remembered. It's her faithfulness that is remembered. In heaven, it's not her forgiven sins that are drawn up before the memory of God. It is what she has done in the cause of God that is remembered. In heaven, it's remembered that at a time and a place where there was not a lot of faith, there was Rahab, and in her there was tremendous faith. Heaven is remembered. And regardless of where you are today, where you are today does not have to define where you are tomorrow. In a minute, in a moment, in an instant in time, Rahab's life was changed forever. Someone knocked on our door. She decided to let me in. Someone spoke to her about this God who was going to lead his people. And she had already heard something, because she's convinced their God's going to win. And for some reason, she chooses to align herself with God. I don't know what choice you've made in life. I don't know where you are tonight. I don't know if you're on the inside of the family of God or if you're on the outside of the family of God. I don't know if you're carrying around reputation from your past and all of your sins, or if you have taken those to the altar, gone to the cross and just left it there beneath the blood of Jesus. Here's what I do know. There's nobody in this auditorium that has gone too far for God to reach. There's none of us that have done something so bad that he can't forgive. There's none of us. In fact, whatever it is we're guilty of, he already paid for. Forgiveness is just as easy as believing Jesus. It can't be that easy. Oh, it's that easy. Because he's already done the hard part. It's just that easy. I'll ask you to stand for a moment. I just ask you to bow your head. I don't know where you're at. I don't know where life finds you. I have no idea where you've been. And nor do I need to know. But here's what I do know. If God would love Rahab, and he did, then he loves you. If God would be willing to forgive Rahab and give her such a wonderful opportunity to do great things for him, God would love you that much. In fact, he does. If God could take someone like Rahab and so transform her life that she becomes a resident of Hebrews chapter 11, where Abraham, Noah, and Moses, Isaac, Jacob, and Sarah, and Rahab use somebody like me? It's a question of, will I let him use somebody like me? Like, that's not a question of, could he make a difference in somebody else?